Welcome to Foundation. Today is a little bit of a shorter episode. I wanted to kind of give you an update on Philip Rosedale, who is the founder of Second Life and now has a new startup called Coffee and Power. We spoke with him in episode number, was that Graham, was two or three?
Three.
So if you haven't seen the full interview, go back and check out episode three. But now let's have a chat with Philip and get an update. So it's been how long now? 2.5 months, something like that, since we shot our last video?
I think so, yeah. I think we got this place in, it was like February, and you were here the next month or so.
Yeah, so what's changed?
Well, a lot of stuff's changed. We started letting people in. We've kind of kitted it out with some metal bar and shelves and a nice coffee table, and of course a disco ball, essential ingredient in every coffee shop. These big screens that we have on the walls that let you see who is working here. Uh-huh. A little sort of kitchenette upstairs, so we've got hot coffee now and water for tea.
Awesome. So for people that are watching this for the first time that didn't happen to catch the last episode, bring me up to speed. Give me like your pitch on exactly what this place is, why you've created it, and what you plan to do with it.
Well, this place is what we call the Coffee and Power Work Club. And our idea is that it's a kind of a co-working space, hopefully for people that are mostly working on software products, but generally kind of mobile workers. We wanted to make a kind of a coffee shop destination that was also a meeting place, maybe a sort of incubator. We wanted to make more of almost a noisy social space as opposed to it being a place where you could like rent a desk. Mm-hmm. So, and we also wanted to make it a space that anybody can come into. And then we kind of use more almost social network techniques to sort out who can hang around and who can be here so that the initial price of entry is zero, is free. And then kind of we'll work out how the rules are around sort of staying here. But we wanted to sort of start with that long tail of just, why can't you just create a lot of value by making a space and letting people in and then letting them work here and seeing how much they can work together and help each other and kind of go from there.
So that's kind of, it has to be tricky, because if you think about a traditional coffee shop, they actually don't want you hanging around for the most part, right?
Exactly.
They limit the number of power outlets because they know laptops run out of juice after a few hours.
Yeah.
Oftentimes charge you for internet.
Yeah.
This place is just getting off the ground. A month from now, this could be packed, right?
And so, it has been sometimes.
Right. So how do you figure out who are you going to cut and when, and how do you even go about developing that system?
Well, I mean, I would say we don't exactly know yet, which is part of the fun of being an entrepreneur and this stuff. But I'll tell you one way I think about it is, if you just go into a cafe and you go, what's the rent here? You know, we're in San Francisco. If you look at a retail cafe space, it's going to be like $3,000 or $4,000 a month in rent. Mm-hmm. And then what you can do is you can say how many chairs are in here, and you can divide by that. And what you'll typically get is a number that looks something like about $20 per chair per day.
Okay.
So like the basic economics of a cafe are $20 a chair a day. So then the question is like, what other ways are there to extract that much value so you can operate other than selling people cups of coffee? And you're exactly right. Like if you do it the coffee way, well, nobody's gonna drink 12 cups of coffee.
I mean, a handful of people probably would, but yeah.
So yeah, you're gonna give people their 2 hours and then you're gonna kinda nudge them out of there. And of course, and that's why we called our new company Coffee and Power, was because electric power is, of course, the one thing that you don't typically get. And a lot of the cafes also like kind of hide their outlets, because I think their thinking is that one laptop charge and one cup of coffee is all you get, and then you got to get out of here. Mm-hmm. But what we felt like was, okay, wait a second, what if we create, given that there's so much entrepreneurial activity in San Francisco, why can't we just create a space where people frequently engage in some sort of value creation with each other when they're in here, whether it's like a meeting or literally, I guess, working alone on their own stuff, or or finding somebody that they might do business with or something like that. And our idea was like, well, at the end of the day, if we can do that successfully and create a great space for that, can't we extract more than $20 per chair per day of value out of that? You know, and, well, and should that be, I guess that could be donations, or it could be, you know,
yeah, that's like yoga studio style. Like some yoga studios, you go in and they're like, give whatever you feel is appropriate, right? You
know, I hear there's a restaurant here too, and I don't know the name of it, but there's a San Francisco area restaurant.
Cafe Gratitude has a bowl called the Community Bowl, where it's like $12 to have lunch there. or you can just pay what you feel it's worth. If you don't have the cash, so you can go in there and say, I only have $2 and I want to buy this bowl, and it's like quinoa and rice and veggies, it's good.
And that's an example, I mean, Cafe Gratitude, right, is an example of high-end food, expensive location, you know, in the Mission, you know, getting more and more fancy over there, and they can survive that way. So I kind of feel like, I mean, if you're inviting people that are doing software development work, or, I mean, I would think that if we're sufficiently transparent about like who's paying and who's not or whatever, I think the right kind of social pressure can be figured out. But that's our idea. Like what we started with was this idea of these big screens where instead of letting you kind of hide and work like you do in a cafe normally, we're trying to say like, no. If you walk in here, we're going to say, Kevin Rose, we're going to put your face up on the screen, and then we're going to put up there like, what do you do for a living? You know, what are you able to do? Maybe like how many, you know, if you've transacted with other people or if you've done other work, you know, in here, how much have you done? You know, kind of put all that stuff out there.
So your little bio is available for anyone that walks in the door.
Exactly. And that's actually the one thing we ask. Like our deal, if you will, with the work club, the only thing we ask you for at this point is that you're willing to sign up and essentially put yourself up on the wall. You know, because the idea is if you're not doing that, then you might not be adding enough value for it to be worth $20 a chair a day.
Right, yeah. And then how do you get, so, you know, let's just say you're successful with the networking component of this. You get people talking, having conversations, like doing deals together. How do you eventually get, so you think it's just donations, or how do you eventually get cash back into the business from that?
I wonder whether we can't survive by coming up with a system where we do a little different than donations. We do something like, if you want to give us a little money because you did a you met somebody here who turned out who you hired or something, you give us a little bit of money. You can even give us money in coffee and power dollars, coffee dollars in our virtual currency. We'll put that forever kind of next to your name. On your account in here. And then maybe what happens is if this place gets really busy, which I think it will, and some days already it gets full of people, particularly in the afternoon with many people being developers. Once it gets really busy, I think the rule is if you've donated or, you know, given the most here, you have the first right to be here. So, you know, given that people will, I don't think we'd ever have to throw people out, but you can almost have like a reservation system where we just told you, oh, there's space available right now. And if you've donated more than anybody else, because we can make that information transparent, we'll give you the first dibs on where you're going to sit. So it's like tied to, hopefully ultimately just tied to value creation. Like the more value you can create here, the more right you have to be here. I think. I mean, we'll see if that works. But the transparency is the key, right? Because with like a tip jar, I've always looked at tip jars in cafes, right? What's the one fatal thing you can do with a tip jar in a cafe is make it opaque. So you don't see how much money is in it. You know, people follow and obey, you know, the social actions of other people around them. So I want to go a lot farther with that and say, okay, I tell you what, let me play a different game. Not only will I show you the tip jar, but I'll show you how much Kevin put in it.
Interesting.
And that, I think, could drive a lot of behavior.
Yeah,
and so
absolutely.
I think that'll find an average, right? Like you'll come by and, you know, maybe you'll put more than the average, but at some point
people
will kind of go.
That will probably raise the bar for everyone else, though.
Yeah.
You know, if someone comes in and throws down $40, your average donation is probably going to go up quite a bit, right? Especially if that's
like
the high
bid
of the day.
You know? Yeah. And then it's like a market behavior. I mean, I'm such a big believer. So much of the work that we're doing with the work list and with Coffee and Power, you know, it's all market-driven behavior. I think that a lot of these market behaviors are like the most efficient ways to quickly sort things out. So this would be an example of that. It's like, just let people donate and then see what the average behavior is, where people know that those who donate more are kind of preferentially treated in some way because there's this pecking order of, you know, who's created the most value.
Interesting. And you could almost have like something that shows a suggested donation based on their activities. And so like if they're more active and they're befriending other people inside of this place,
it's less,
then it's
right.
less. And if they're like more stagnant, they don't do anything, then their suggested donation goes up over time even. So they're sitting there at the desk, you could leave that window open.
Yeah.
And it's like when you start off, it's like you don't have to do anything. But, you know, an hour later, it's like, yeah, you should donate $3. You know?
And that's what's, you know, when you look at Coffee and Power, and so, you know, we have these two things, Coffee and Power on the work list, which the work list is our worklist.net is the software development tool that we've built, and then Coffee and Power is like the same thing but for everything else, for like errands or teaching or you know, coaching, whatever, anything people are wanting to do in it, like in the city, we think initially. because we can observe the transactions in both of those systems in real time, yeah, you're totally right, right? Hmm. Like if you do something that's of value, even if it's just chatting, like you said,
yeah,
or transacting or something like that, then we're like, yeah, you're totally free. Don't even bother
this,
paying us.
Yeah,
you
this
know?
Could be,
we got you.
This could be really cool. If you had a list of always present tasks that would kind of positively impact your account and overall standing. So like, for example, let's just say I've been sitting here for like 3 hours and it's like, your suggested donation is $5. And all of a sudden I'm like, well, I don't have $5 today, but if I tweet this out, it's gonna remove three of those yeah. dollar credits. Or if yeah. I go check the bathroom, make sure there's toilet paper stocked,
yes,
it removes
exactly.
an extra $1.50 or something.
Totally you know?
And you have all these tasks that are just up there that I can always yeah. do and jump in, and that's my contribution. It's almost like a little community of people yeah. helping out each other.
Yeah, like we're gonna get a nice espresso machine, right? So somebody could come and, you know, somebody with the kind of experiences you've had could come and like be like, I'll bring you tea.
Right.
You know, I'll walk around and I'll give people tea. I
mean, right.
Wouldn't that be worth, you know, $5 to us? Oh my, I mean, of course.
Right, or you could have other people donate on their behalf. So if
yeah.
I go around and fill up people's tea, then,
yeah.
then you could come in and say, like, you know what, Kevin's been awesome. He's been spending the last half hour giving everyone tea. I'm gonna do $1 in his bucket or $2 in his bucket for him.
It's interesting that you bring that up, because I think that idea of donating on somebody else's behalf, we thought of that like a couple of months ago, and it's interesting because now I bet that's a good way to do it, where you could do exactly that. If somebody helps you out, you can essentially cover them. I mean, imagine, right? Like if you walked in here, and this has been actually happening since we opened, if you walked in here and you met somebody else who's like, I'm an iPhone developer, and you're like, well, I have this very simple app that I want that, you know, we don't mostly do iPhone development, but we've got this one idea, it's gonna make the business a little better.
Mm-hmm.
That person does it for you for, you know, $200, you know, over their lunch break. I mean, why don't you give another $200 to the work club, which covers
right.
their sitting here for months, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, totally.
That's awesome. So where does this go from here? I mean, you're just gonna constantly continue to iterate and develop on top of the platform. I think you have people waiting to come in. That's awesome.
Oh, hey, Grayson. You know, where are we gonna go from there? I think that a couple of directions. I mean, like right now, the biggest thing that I'm thinking about as an entrepreneur mm-hmm. is getting Coffee and Power, like working as a generalized way for people to exchange small services with each other.
Mm-hmm. They don't have to take place inside of the actual
don't
location.
Necessarily have to be here in the work club. So like the way we're thinking about it is initially we're gonna try and get Coffee and Power going, which we're gonna do in the next few weeks, start getting a lot of people using it. If it turns out that having a physical space like this to meet and do things like teaching in, like we've seen a lot of Coffee and Power contracts that are like, I will show you how to use jQuery,
mm-hmm.
or you know, something like that.
Right.
It makes a lot of sense, right? You really do need to sit with somebody, and you're not gonna like go to their office or their house. You're gonna wanna meet
right.
in a cafe or
yeah,
something, and they sit next to you, and they're like, yeah, let me give you a brief tutorial on this programming technique.
It's a lot more casual when you meet at a cafe than like to say like, hey, come over to my house, and
yeah.
that's just weird, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So like, I think that if that idea works, if it turns out that a physical space really amplifies the success of Coffee and Power,
mm-hmm.
then we'll just go like open a lot of them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If the economics work and it's supporting a larger number of transactions going on in Coffee and Power, then we'll just replicate this idea and you'll see these, you know, Coffee and Power signs all over the place. As places to come and work. I mean, that'd be awesome if that works out.
And you are developing your own currency then, right?
We are, right. So like the other
talk to me about the hurdles surrounding
yeah.
that. Like
yeah.
there's restrictions, like there must be government
yeah.
hurdles and all kinds of things, right? Or
yeah, I mean, at a high level.
You've
I mean,
done
yeah,
this.
So like on the currency side, we've done this already. I've done this some with Second Life.
Right.
And so there are, I mean, oh my God, I mean, the regulatory stuff varies from state to state and country to country, obviously, and there's all kinds of complexity depending on exactly what you do and what you let people do and not do. And then there's like reporting and taxes, and there's just all kinds of stuff that goes
mm-hmm.
with it. But nevertheless, I mean, when we look at Coffee and Power, it's basically like trying to get people to do things of value for each other, you know, small services, basically. And so the question is really like, what's gonna make small services work in general,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, there's a lot of companies right now, not a lot, I mean, there's a good number of companies right now that are like, hey, let's figure out an alternative to something like Craigslist.
Mm-hmm.
But something that's focused on maybe like more live transactions or more, you know, hey, I've got an hour to spare, I can do the following thing. I think that category is great, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what we're trying to do with Coffee and Power. But what's gonna make it work that's magical about it? And I think one potential thing that could help and really make it work is an alternative currency, because then people can make transactions with each other extremely fast, so you're not like waiting, you're not running it through like a merchant processing network. Mm-hmm. They can make really small transactions. So like we were talking about with the, you know, you brought me my tea, I could give you like $1 or $2 just kind of as a social token, but it's real money. Mm-hmm. But of course you could never really do that. It would be very hard to do that like with Visa, you know,
because right.
we both, I mean, somebody's got to shoulder the cost of running that whole transaction right. through the merchant network. So if you use an alternative currency, you can keep everybody sort of in the system. The other thing is, and I think we saw this dynamic with other systems in the past, like eBay and PayPal, where in the beginning, if people sort of make a little money, so like if I go and I teach you boxing, you know, which I've done through Coffee and Power, you know, if I teach people boxing at lunchtime and I make a little bit of money, I'm a lot more likely to re-spend that money sort of inside the community
Absolutely.
And the network that's established.
Yeah.
Rather than if it just comes to my credit card, it's both kind of almost less fun
right.
because I don't have this cachet of like coffee dollars that I've made.
Right.
And I'm less likely to re-spend it within the network, which means right. that the network of transactions might die out because
sure.
there's just not enough collision, so to speak.
Yeah, this
so
is part of the reason I pay for things with PayPal. It's like, I'm like, oh, I have $18 sitting in there.
Right,
you know, and
with PayPal,
I don't want to
take
the time to like withdraw it. It's in that network, so I'll log in and buy stuff through there just because
yeah.
it's easier, you know, sometimes.
Yeah, and I mean, PayPal is not even really officially an alternative currency because
right.
it's just dollars.
I right.
mean, it's demarked in dollars or euros or whatever. So we think that's one thing, but we actually think there are like a couple of other things too about like getting the services market to work with something like Coffee and Power. Another one is that people have to see each other and be in contact as a social community, I think, to make stuff like that take off. Like when you look back at the very beginning at eBay, and I learned about this because eBay, Pierre Omidyar and the eBay gang, well, Pierre was an investor in Second Life and then eBay was really supportive of us. So we got a chance to look at the history of eBay and like what worked. And one of the things that a lot of people don't know is that forums. So when Pierre set up eBay, he literally just downloaded, because it was that time, like mid-90s, so he's just going around on his Linux servers and just picking up different pieces of software that he could just throw out there for his early stage auction system. Mm-hmm. And one of them was he found a piece of forum software and he put it on there, you know, which is just like the same forum software we see everywhere. But this was novel, you know, it was like 1995.
Mm-hmm.
And people just totally started talking mm-hmm. in these forums, and they'd be talking about, oh my God, I sold this thing on eBay, I can't believe it, it was my grandmother's or whatever. And that communication, actually, if you ask Pierre, is one of the very key things that made eBay survive and take off. So it wasn't actually the Tiffany lamp that was being sold between two people on eBay. Mm-hmm. It wasn't that.
It was the initial community that got together.
Yeah,
and
it was like how cool it was. Like you and
right.
I got to meet each other. Like, cool, you sold me that lamp. What else? And, you
right.
know, it was the conversation. So we think that like
kind of like Etsy in a way it got
yeah,
to that.
Totally like
yeah.
that, right? Like we think that if people are able, and if you look at some of the other stuff that's being done out there around like sharing things, ride sharing and things like that, I think you start to see some of the same stuff where mm-hmm. I think very effective systems are going to be ones that have a lot of communication built in. That's actually the thing that we think is also really important. And then the other thing is letting people advertise what they can do rather than what they want. Because if you think about it, early stage marketplaces are often kind of created by people that have extra time and energy and can provide some kind of service, as opposed to just aggregating the buyers together. Because the interests of buyers are all, like I always think about, if I'm gonna give, I'm a CEO, you know, former CEO of Second Life, I could give you advice on a startup. You could give somebody awesome advice on a startup. But is anybody, like how many emails a day do you get? Well, you probably get some, but how many emails a day from some entrepreneurs do you get where the entrepreneur is like, Kevin, I'm a total idiot. I would like to take you to lunch and just have you give me advice. Most people are not psychologically going to do that. That's
mm-hmm.
a tough,
right.
that's a pretty humble thing to do. But what if you have an extra 2 hours and you're in some interesting city and you go on your phone and you're like, if somebody wants to take me to lunch right now, I'll be whatever help I can be
yeah.
to you.
I've actually
somebody's going to take you up on that instantly.
Yeah, I've done that. I was in, oh gosh, I can't remember what city it was, but I had no friends there and I was just there for a day or two and I tweeted out, hey, I'm gonna do this little drink up, come meet up, blah, 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 and then a bunch of people showed up and we just had a great conversation and hung
totally.
Out and blah, blah,
but
blah.
That was because you were the seller, in a sense, you were the provider of that
right.
service
yep.
and you listed it in with a tweet in this case. Mm-hmm. So like one of the things we think is that coffee and power can work if we make it really easy, not so much for people to say what they want, because people they don't know or maybe they just won't say, but for you to say what you have to offer.
Right.
And then people will cluster around that. And so that's another dynamic that we think is at least testable. So like that, alternative currency,
Sweet.
A few of these things that are different about coffee and power.
So why not go Bitcoin?
Yeah, why not use Bitcoin,
we've
right?
We talked about it a little bit, but I'd love to get your thoughts on camera.
Well, yeah, we've talked about this, and as you know, I'm like a huge fan and fascinated by what I think is the almost inevitable process of different types of digital currencies emerging worldwide that are different than the traditional currencies that we use today, like dollars and euros. And Bitcoin, of course, is totally kind of in the news, just even since the last time we talked, right? With all this interest in it. So Bitcoin, I think, is a very interesting idea. It has one big challenge, but it may actually work even with that challenge. What it does, basically, I mean, for those who don't know, what Bitcoin does is, it basically is a currency that is not controlled by any one party, which is such an important and interesting idea. I mean, it really, like the internet before it, it really seems like it seems like something that 10 years from now we're going to go, duh. I mean,
right.
Of course we would do a token currency that way. So the trick with Bitcoin is that you give everybody a little bit of this new currency, but you have to somehow manage how much of the currency exists, obviously, mm-hmm. or you'll have fraud and you'll have cheating and you'll have too much of it, basically. Mm-hmm. So the way Bitcoin does it is really, really cool, especially for people like listening to this that are into development. It's such a cool idea. They basically have a public, very hard cryptography problem that requires a lot of CPU cycles. And what they say is, if you'll tell everybody else that you like factored this large number, and here's the answer, everybody agrees we'll give you a dollar. We'll give you a Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. And that's, I'm way oversimplifying. This is totally not, what I'm describing is like very, very much oversimplifying it. But that's basically the idea. So everybody ends up getting a little bit of money by just using CPUs on the network to essentially search for those answers.
Right.
Now, what's the problem
with that?
They call
it like mining, I think.
Mining, yep. So the problem with that, there's one problem, and they talk about it on their site too, and it'll be really interesting as a person who's into macroeconomics, what's gonna happen. The one problem is that as people hear about Bitcoin, you're gonna have this big wave of early adoption, just like Dig or just like Second Life, where everybody's gonna come and get in. Mm-hmm. Well, that is gonna be an interesting situation because there are only so many Bitcoins, and the number of Bitcoins being created isn't sensitive to how many people are signing up or using Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. So what that means is that people are gonna want to buy Bitcoins a lot. And so the value of a Bitcoin is going to go up.
Right.
Now you might say, of course, as a speculator, hey, awesome, I have some Bitcoins, they're worth more. But for those who aren't into this stuff, there's a big macroeconomic problem associated with that, which is hoarding. It's called it's deflation. Mm-hmm. So when the value of a currency starts to go up really quickly, mm-hmm. it's a super bad situation and it can be a downward spiral because everybody stops spending because they believe that rather than buying a TV today, they'll be able to buy two TVs in a week with the same currency. And so the natural behavior is not to spend. So there's this problem of a deflationary, Bitcoin is what you'd call a deflationary economy, meaning it's going to increase and increase in value. And so the question is the speculation that comes from that going to be destructive to Bitcoin and people just won't use it? I don't know. Bitcoin themselves says let's just see what happens. And I think it's a totally fascinating thing to watch play out. I think there's going to be a lot of issues around regulation, and it's totally anonymous.
Yeah, the anonymous part is really interesting.
Yeah.
And the fact that you actually store your currency on the machine is something that takes some getting used to. Because, with going into a cloud type environment now, I'm so used to logging in for my PayPal or logging in for my Gmail or whatever, and have it follow me around no matter where I am.
Yeah.
And, I had, maybe $7 in Bitcoin because I asked people to send
How did you buy them?
I just said I'm doing a test and I tweeted it out. I'm like, send me just a couple
cents.
Oh, send
me some, that's right.
Yeah, and some people sent me a fraction of a cent. Some people sent me a dollar or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then I formatted my computer to install OS X Lion. Mm-hmm. And I forgot that I even had my Bitcoin on
there.
You
lost it.
And it's gone. And there was that story about that theft that happened.
Yeah.
somebody had a couple hundred thousand dollars.
Yeah, was that for real? I didn't go into that.
Yeah, so apparently you can't trace it, right? So it's just like you found some cash laying on the street. So
right.
Someone can hack into my computer.
Right. I know they say like if I can decode, you have to have like a couple of levels of passwords because right. if I can decode even one, you're totally screwed. I can take it away from
right.
you and then transact with it and then it's not good anymore on the network. Yeah. I mean, that's fascinating, right?
Yeah.
I mean, how are we going to deal with that? But don't you think, though, that some entrepreneurs like you or me will build and I've thought about this a lot because, as you know, I've thought about digital currency in the context of sort of R&D projects. Somebody, I bet, will build a wallet for Bitcoins that right. is secure and it's cloud-based.
Oh, yeah. There is a couple of them out there, actually.
Are there?
There's one that was, but then you have to worry about that site getting hacked into. They basically have to have the bank of or the security of a bank, right? Someone logs in and it's like they can transfer out your Bitcoins or whatever.
And then like what will the FDIC be in the future world of electronic currency, right?
So
the FDIC in the United States, right, is a government insurance that insures
your deposit. $150,000 or $250,000, something like that.
But if you think about it, I mean, and this is market stuff, right? Doesn't it seem logical that somebody will just do the same thing? I mean, again, you or I could start a business tomorrow that did exactly this, that was like a Bitcoin wallet service, and then you know what we could do? We could go to Lloyd's of London, right? I mean, we're, you know, diligent guys who could go and explain who we are and everything. If we go to Lloyd's of London, we can basically get an insurance policy mm-hmm. that protects against loss, provided we prove to Lloyd's that we're reasonably defensively secure.
Right.
And then we're essentially offering FDIC, right? Because then we can go to our customers
right.
and we can say, and you know what? We've got an insurance policy and money on deposit that will cover you if we ever lost your money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, think about, I mean, that just makes me smile because it's like, why does the government need to do that for us?
It just sounds so messy.
In an era of so much technology.
Would you ever want to be in that business? I mean, it sounds.
I don't think I would want to be in that business, which is part of why, and you know, we've talked about this on the R&D side. I have thought a huge amount about all this stuff and I absolutely love it, but I don't know if I'd want to run that business
right.
because boy, I mean, the business of money is a tough one.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tough one. But you know, why doesn't Coffee and Power use Bitcoin? I don't know, because there's not enough people using Bitcoin.
Right.
I mean, we've got our own challenges of just getting Coffee and Power to launch
right.
and get a lot of people using it.
You could potentially create a client that, because it's all open source.
We could convert from or to Bitcoins,
or,
right?
Or just, yeah, exactly. I don't know, something to think about.
I think if it's successful, we'll do it. I mean, you know, I mean, if it's legal, or I mean, to the extent that we can do it, you know, legally as a single company, you know, support it.
Cool.
It'd be great.
So real quick to wrap things up, tell me your location. People don't know where you're at and what people can do to help, when they should show up.
Yeah, so this place is the Work Club and the location is 1825 Market Street, which is in San Francisco in what's called the upper market area at Market and Pearl. And we are generally here like weekdays work hours
mm-hmm.
and we're, everybody is welcome. We'd love to see, you know, everybody here that's, especially if you're involved in software development. And there's lots of chairs and spaces to go. And you can also go to coffeeandpower.com and there's a button there that says find the Work Club and it'll actually show you who's here and then a live video stream coming from the cameras
awesome.
Up there. So like theoretically, like people on there right now are watching us interview, watching you interview me. So
awesome.
Very strange.
And then if they want updates, they follow you on Twitter.
They can follow us on Twitter at Coffee and Power.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And see what's going on.
Awesome. Well, thanks for being
cool.
on the show again. Appreciate
it. Thanks for coming.
And I'll be
Good
stopping
be
in soon.
Cool. All right.